Welcome to the Chapter 27 lecture on Aggregate Demand and Aggregate Supply. This chapter includes many concepts from the previous chapter, so it is important that you have a good understanding of what we have already covered in order for this chapter to make sense.
The model of aggregate demand and aggregate supply can be used to analyze short-run economic fluctuations in the economy. The model focuses on the behavior of two variables, real GDP and the price level. Remember that real GDP is the economy's output of goods and services, and the price level is the overall level of prices in the economy measured by the consumer price index or the GDP deflator. The word aggregate means in total or of all. Aggregate demand shows the quantity of all goods and services demanded in the economy. Aggregate supply shows the quantity of all goods and services that firms can produce in the economy. The aggregate demand, aggregate supply, or ADAS model can be shown on a diagram. The price level is a nominal variable and is on the vertical axis. The quantity of output, which is a real variable, since it is measured by real GDP, is on the horizontal axis. The aggregate supply, or AS, curve is upward sloping, and the aggregate demand curve, or AD, is downward sloping. Equilibrium occurs where the two curves cross, giving us the equilibrium price level, P star, and the equilibrium quantity of output, Q star. The aggregate demand curve shows the quantity of goods and services that households, firms, government, and foreigners want to buy at each price level. The aggregate demand curve is downward sloping. As prices decrease, the quantity demanded will rise. In order to explain this relationship, remember the GDP equation of Y equals C plus I plus G plus MX. Let's assume that government spending is fixed by policy and the economy is closed, so there are no exports or imports. This means that consumption and investment are the only variables that depend on economic conditions, especially the price level. The wealth effect explains the inverse relationship between the price level P and consumption C. An increase in the price level reduces the real value of money. When wealth is reduced, people are encouraged to spend less, therefore decreasing the quantity demanded of goods and services. The interest rate effect explains the inverse relationship between the price level P and investment I. A decrease in the price level reduces the amount of money people hold. Households buy interest-bearing bonds with excess money, driving down interest rates. Lower interest rates encourage borrowing, therefore increasing the quantity of goods and services. The aggregate demand curve does not stay in one spot. It can shift if one of the variables of GDP change. If there is a change in consumption, C, such as people becoming more concerned about retirement and saving more money, a stock market boom, or a change in taxes. When people change their consumption patterns, aggregate demand will shift. If there is a change in investment, I, due to a change in expectations about the future or a change in tax policy, then the aggregate demand will shift. Government spending, G, can change if there are adjustments to fiscal policy. Fiscal policy is the President and Congress's decisions about how much money to spend and how much to tax. Lastly, a change in net exports, NX, due to a change in exchange rates or the world economy can shift the aggregate demand curve. The aggregate supply curve shows the quantity of all goods and services firms can produce and sell at any price level. The slope of the aggregate supply curve depends on the time horizon. The long-run aggregate supply curve, LRAS, is vertical, and the short-run aggregate supply curve, the SRAS, is upward sloping. labor, capital, natural resources, and technology determine the quantity of goods and services firms can produce in the long run. The quantity of output produced in the long run does not depend on the price level. The long-run aggregate supply curve is a graphical representation of the classical dichotomy and monetary neutrality. Since labor, capital, natural resources, and technology are all real variables, and the price level does not affect them. On the aggregate demand, aggregate supply model, the long-run aggregate supply curve is drawn as a vertical line, intersecting the horizontal axis at the natural rate of output. The natural rate of output is the long-run level of production that occurs when the economy is experiencing unemployment at its natural rate. You should remember the natural rate of unemployment from Chapter 10. Any change in one of the four factors of production can shift the long-run aggregate supply curve. A change in the amount of labor stock, a change in the amount of capital stock, a change in the amount of natural resources, or a change in technology. The short-run aggregate supply curve is much different than the long-run aggregate supply curve. In the short run, prices can influence real output because monetary neutrality breaks down. When prices increase, the quantity supplied of goods and services increase. When prices decrease, the quantity supplied of goods and services decrease. This is a positive relationship. Economists have three theories as to why the short-run aggregate supply curve is upward sloping, reflecting the positive relationship between price and quantity supplied. The underlying theory is the quantity supplied of output deviates from its long-run or natural rate when actual prices deviate from expected prices. Since firms make expectations about the future, the difference between their expectations and what really happens to prices can alter their level of production. If actual prices are greater than what firms expect, then firms will earn more profits than expected, and output rises above the natural rate. If actual prices are less than expected prices, then firms will be earning less profits than anticipated, and output will fall below the natural rate. The first theory to explain the upward sloping short-run aggregate supply curve is sticky wages. Wages are sticky in the short run. Nominal wages are based on expected prices and do not adjust quickly when actual prices differ from expected prices. Wages are sticky because most people have salary contracts for 1 year and due to social norms. Your employer typically doesn't give you a raise just because. If actual prices are less than expected prices, production becomes less profitable. Firms decrease production and labor instead of lowering costs by decreasing wages. The second theory is sticky prices. Some prices are slow to adjust to changing economic conditions due to the menu costs of changing prices or due to supply contracts. If actual prices are less than expected prices, firms cannot adjust quickly. Therefore, they decrease production instead of reducing prices. The third theory is called misperceptions theory. A change in the price level can mislead suppliers. If actual prices are less than expected prices, firms think it is specific to their industry and decrease production. The short-run aggregate supply curve does not stay in one spot. The SRAS can shift if there's a change in labor stock, a change in capital stock, a change in natural resources, a technological change, or a change in expected prices. If expected prices increase, so do costs of production, and the supply curve will decrease by shifting left. If expected prices fall, so do costs of production, and the supply curve will increase by shifting right. Aggregate demand, aggregate supply equilibrium. In the long run, equilibrium occurs when aggregate demand equals the long run aggregate supply curve. This is when real GDP equals the natural rate of output. In the short run, equilibrium occurs when the aggregate demand curve equals the short run aggregate supply curve. This is when the quantity demanded of output equals the quantity supplied of output. Full equilibrium occurs when the aggregate demand curve equals the short run aggregate supply curve, which equals the long run aggregate supply curve. To see full equilibrium on a diagram, the price level is on the vertical, and the quantity of output measured by real GDP is on the horizontal. The short run aggregate supply curve is upward sloping due to sticky wages, sticky prices, and misperceptions theory. The aggregate demand curve is downward sloping due to the wealth effect and interest rate effect. The long-run aggregate supply curve is vertical at the natural rate of output, which is the level of output produced when the economy is experiencing the natural rate of unemployment. All three curves cross at the same point to give us full equilibrium and the corresponding equilibrium price level P star. The natural rate of output is labeled as adverse shifts in stagflation. Stagflation is when output falls while prices rise. This is a period of a recession and inflation. Stagflation is caused by adverse shifts in the short-run aggregate supply curve, typically due to energy shocks. Policymakers can offset the fall in the short-run aggregate supply curve by increasing aggregate demand, but prices increase permanently. If policymakers do not take action, the market would eventually return to the natural rate of output and the equilibrium price level. An example of an adverse supply shock is the OPEC oil crisis in 1973-1979. OPEC restricted the supply of oil and the world price of oil rose sharply. We can look at this on a simple supply and demand diagram. As the supply curve decreases, the result is higher prices and a lower quantity available. Higher energy costs cause the short-run aggregate supply curve to shift left. Since oil is an input into the production of many goods and services, mostly due to transportation costs, the higher price of oil causes production costs to increase. As production costs increase, firms are less profitable and the short-run aggregate supply curve shifts left. On the diagram, we can see that as the short-run aggregate supply curve decreases, the result is higher prices and a lower quantity of output. This means the economy is experiencing inflation and a recession at the same time. The Fed can take action by conducting expansionary monetary policy. The Fed would do an open market operation purchase, decrease the federal funds rate, interest rates would fall, investment and consumption would increase, and the aggregate demand curve would shift right. Output would return to the natural rate, but inflation is even higher. We can see this effect on the diagram. As the aggregate demand curve shifts right, we return to a new full equilibrium, showing that the price level has increased even higher, but output has returned to the natural rate. This is the end of the Chapter 15 lecture on aggregate demand and aggregate supply. If you have any questions about the key concepts from this chapter, please post a question and ask Professor Papula or send me an email.